We choose to go to the moon. We choose to go to the moon. We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other things, not because they are easy, but because they are hard. We set sail on this new sea because there is new knowledge to be gained and new rights to be won. And they must be won and used for the progress of all mankind. We shall send to the moon, 240,000 miles away from the control station in Houston, a giant rocket more than 300 feet tall, made of new metal alloys, some of which have not yet been invented, capable of standing heat and stresses several times more than have ever been experienced, fitted together with a precision better than the finest watch, carrying all the equipment needed for propulsion, guidance, control, communications, food, and survival, on an untried mission to an unknown celestial body. And therefore, as we set sail, we ask God's blessing on the most hazardous and dangerous and greatest adventure on which man has ever embarked. Thank you.
Like a person waiting in the wings to go on stage, they probably have less time to daydream because they're trying to remember what they've got to do. You know, I had a feeling that I really ought to concentrate on remembering the things that I had to do at the moon and all that.
Gosh, here we are, and we're getting down close. I hope the suit checks out okay. You get sweaty palms and heart starts pounding. It was like the big game about to start.
You're in your work clothes, ready to go to work. But you still have to stay there. You have to schedule it in conjunction with the booster schedule itself. You're plugged into the console. It's supplying 100% oxygen. It's kind of a catch-up time. If there's a problem with a booster or something, we're there not sitting out the pad until the count gets to a certain point, and then we're called to proceed to the spacecraft.
Right at the last minute, there was a psychological block in there that said, don't count on this so heavily. It might not happen. This is such a big thing. I frankly don't see how you can do it. Even when participating in it, I think it's audacious that you would try. I clearly could never understand, as a crewman, how to make it work. I could only learn how to operate my share of it. Thank you. being command pilot, I was sitting in the center seat, so that meant I climbed in last. I just stood around and waited until they strapped in. And here was a kind of a strange quiet. Look out and you can see the large part of the state and the ocean. And this thing out here, you have the feeling that it's alive. That's the kind of thing that sort of, for the first time, begins to bring home the fact that today is not the game we've been playing and training for years. This is reality. I had the only window at this point, and I looked out, and doggone if the moon wasn't visible in the daylight, right straight out the top of the window. I know they're doing their job right, because the moon's right straight ahead, and that's where we're pointed, and you know, they're just gonna launch us right straight to this thing.
This is Apollo Saturn Launch Control. All still go on the Apollo mission, the flight to land of the first men on the moon. Spacecraft also now is on full internal power. So up to this time, it had been sharing the load with an external power source. Once we get down to the 3-minute and 10-second mark in the countdown, we'll go on an automatic sequence. All aspects from there on down will be automatic, run by the ground master computer here in the firing room.
Exactly. They don't have any place to cover it down.
He's not giving exactly. He's just looking across the flight plane to find out what the hell the trend is.
We have some 7.6 million pounds of thrust pushing the vehicle upwards. The vehicle it weighs close to 6.5 million pounds.
We all are in this together as a team effort. We're gonna make it work. And I don't know how to make it work. I don't know how to do most of this mission, but I do know that I can assure you that my piece of it is gonna work, and you won't fail because of me.
The members of the launch team here in the control center monitoring a number of what we call red line values. These are tolerances we don't want to go above and below in temperatures and pressures. They're standing by to call out any deviations from our plans. All indications coming in to the control center at this time indicate we are go. The test supervisor now is informed. Launch vehicle test conductor, you are go for launch. 3 minutes, 25 seconds and counting. We're still go at this time.
There's a long period of time where you've done all the things in the cockpit you can do, and there are very few things left to say. You don't know any new jokes to tell. There's just not much left to say except just sit there and wait.
It feels good.
Astronauts report it feels good. 1 minute, 25 seconds and counting. Our status board indicates the third stage completely pressurized. Guidance system goes on internal at 17 seconds, leading up to the ignition sequence at 8.9 seconds. Power transfer is complete. Firing command coming in now. We are on the automatic sequence. T-minus 60 seconds and counting. We're launch vehicle at this time. All the second stage tanks now pressurized. 35 seconds and counting.
Go.
It won't fail because of me.
T-minus 20 seconds and counting. Guidance internal. 15, 14, 13. 12, 11, 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0, ignition, T-com, launch commit, go.
just like it sounds.
I got a pitch and a roll program, and this baby is really going.
Roger that. Stand by for mode 1 Bravo. Mark 1 Bravo.
That's a lovely liftoff. That's not bad at all.
It's a moment there just of supreme elation, complete release of tensions. To feel all that power precisely directed, know that we're on course, first of all, for Earth orbit, and then precisely inserted onto the right orbit, right trajectory for rendezvous with the moon.
Apollo Houston, you're right smack dab on the trajectory. Your IU's doing a beautiful job.
I got a yaw program.
Trajectory's good. Thrust is good.
Run away, Houston.
At last, I'm leaving the Earth, and I'm destined for the moon.
What a ride. What a ride.
Roger, we copy, Pete.
Roger, looks good up here, too.
Roll's complete.
You can feel it shake. There's a real strong vibration. Of course, you're up at the end of this beauty. Here you are going along with the G on you. It's up to about 4 G's, but you're psyched up, good shape and all that. Even lifting your arm to move switches, no problem.
You are go for staging.
Here you are coming up on staging, and when staging happens, it's like, man.
That was shut down, right on the money.
17 Houston, you are go for orbit. Go for orbit.
And we're out over the Canaries.
Houston, through the Canaries. How do you read?
You're loud and clear, Houston, over the Canaries. Boy, it's just beautiful up here. Looking out the window, it's just really fantastic.
Roger.
Let me tell you a little bit about the ride.
John, this is Houston. If there's nothing startling to report about the ride, we'd rather hold off.
No, there's nothing really spectacular different to report on the ride. We'll hold off on that.
The sunset is just as beautiful as always in the space business.
In Africa, there are a lot of nomads out in the desert. Clear desert nights, you see the fires from all of these. These little yellow dots that represented fires from all of these nomads camping out. And you realize the broad area that you're looking at. And each of those little dots represented people, other humans that are out there in an environment which I would consider more strange than the environment they might think about me.
When you get there in an orbit, engines shut down, and things sort of feel sort of funny, and you sort of unbuckle your seatbelt and wiggle around in your seat or tap your toes, and all of a sudden you're just bodies everywhere in the room, and you're just doing flips and cartwheels and spins.
Your first feelings of weightlessness as it hits you is like going down a country road about 60 miles an hour, and a car goes over the bump and your stomach goes up into your throat, and then you get over the bump and you get that good sensation feeling, and then bomb, you're back down again. Only when you're in space and you go into weightlessness, you go over that bump and you never come down.
Twelve, Houston, your program alarm was an integration problem. can you give us a verb 96 enter to stop your integration? And we'd like you to do an EMOD dump. Give us a 3-2-1 mark when you do your verb 74. And if we get it done now, we should have an answer for you on your erasable memory by the time you get to Wimus. Do a verb 96 first.
We had a great deal of difficulty paying attention to what our job was. Already I was getting the impression that this is such an amazing thing that I'm going to forget these things. I know I'm going to lose this image, it's going to be replaced with another. Each image came up, was there for a flash to be appreciated and savored, and then reluctantly let go because you know that it's going to be superposed with others.
And Houston, we're beginning to see a beautiful sunrise here.
Okay, we're giving you a go for your EVA at this time.
Okay, the hatch is open, no sweat. No, it stays just where I want it.
When you're outside in one of those spacesuits, you're really in space. There are no boundaries to what you're seeing. It's like having a goldfish bowl over your head, which gives you unlimited visibility. And then the portable life support system is just very, very quiet. You know, there's a water pump in it that's circulating water through your underwear, you know, cooling water. And there's a fan that's pumping the oxygen through, but they're very quiet. You can't hear them at all. It's as if you're out there without anything on.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Houston.
Sort of total, complete silence and that beautiful view. And the realization, of course, that you're going 25,000 miles an hour. Recognize that you're not there because you deserve to be there. You were just lucky. You're the representative of humanity at that point in history, having that experience, in a sense, for the rest of mankind.
The flight director says get back in.
Apollo Control, Houston. 2 hours, 25 minutes ground elapsed time. It will be during this pass that we will have the translunar injection burn.
Capcom, we're go for TLI.
Roger. Guys, I've got the word you wanted to hear. You are go for TLI. You're go for the moon.
If there's anything to be a little bit remorseful about on going to the moon, it was that you didn't get a chance to spend as much time around the Earth as you'd like, because there's an awful lot of very interesting things to see.
3, 2, 1, ignition.
We confirm ignition and the thrust is go.
You guys are really hauling the mail out of there.
Oh, you better believe it. It's like we're climbing straight out, Joe. It's a fantastic sight. It's like we were shot straight up.
You're going about 6,000 feet a second.
Present altitude is now about 3,000 miles. Spacecraft moving at nearly 35,000 feet per second. These three crew members are traveling faster than man has ever flown before.
There's not much sensation of what's really happening, except that we're looking at the computer, and the computer is adding up the velocity. And suddenly, we really knew that we were already traveling. And shoot, when that engine lit off, it was on for a long time.
Shut down.
But it really hit us when it stopped, when we turned around and looked at the Earth. Suddenly, the Earth had started to shrink.
Recorder on board, which you could listen to the music. We were allowed to carry a personal cassette on there so you could play the music. Mine was country music.
Hi, this is Buck Owens from the Buckaroos. We came down to the studio and we thought we'd put together a little thing that you could take along with you on your trip. Now, you know, when you get back, they're probably going to put you in the movies. So the first thing we're going to do for you is to play a little song called Act Naturally. It goes like this. They're going to put me in the movies. They're going to make a big star out of me. Well, we'll make a scene about a man that's sad and lonely. And all I got to do is act naturally. Well, I'll bet you I'm going to be a big star. You might win an Oscar, you can't ever tell. The movies are gonna make me a big star, 'cause I can play the part so well. Well, I hope you'll come to see me in my movie, and I know that you're gonna plainly see the biggest fool that's ever hit the big time. And all I gotta do is act naturally. By the way, gang, you know we're making this tape, and they're going to the moon. They're on the way to the moon right now. Oh.
Anybody up there, read me. This is Houston.
You don't think of it as Texas or the United States. You really think of it as Earth. The three things that I associated with Earth were people and green trees and fresh water.
This is something a little different for me. My name is Merle Haggard, and this is my band, The Strangers. And I hope that we will be able to do something you'll enjoy hearing on your way to the moon. And, of course, we hope that you come back. But we want you to leave this tape there, okay? We want this tape to be out of sight.
Someday, when our green world finds us, these hard times are gone. We'll laugh and count our blessings in a mansion all our own. If we both pull together, tomorrow's sure to come. Someday we'll look back and
you get ready to eat. It'll say right on there, command module pilot, day 3, meal 2. And so you take that packet out, and you may have 2 drinks and 3 or 4 different types of food in there. So you've got to find a spot to stick these, or they're going to float off. And then you've got to get the water gun. You got to mix up the drinks and mix up the food and knead them around and not let everything float off in the interim.
Someday we'll look back and say it was fun. Someday when our dream world finds us, these hard times.
The only bad part about zero gravity in Apollo was going to the bathroom. We had a very crude system. for your feces, it was a bag. And you put this bag in the right position, and so you go. But the only thing is that nothing goes to the bottom of the bag in zero gravity. Everything floats. So you've got this bag, and then the problem is getting it off and closing up the bag, making sure everything's still in the bag.
Someday we'll look back and say that a good time on the way to the moon didn't.
Houston, are you still planning to have TV at the scheduled time?
Right. You can go ahead with the TV now. We're standing by.
Hello, Houston. We've got a beautiful view of the Earth here, but it's absolutely fantastic.
We're standing by at this time to receive the first television transmission from the spacecraft.
Houston, we're now showing you a view of the Earth through the telephoto lens. This transmission is coming to you approximately halfway between the moon and the Earth.
It makes you realize just what you have back there on Earth. The Earth from here is a grand oasis of the big vastness of space. What I keep imagining is if I'm some lonely traveler from another planet, would I land on the blue or the brown part of the Earth?
Okay, world, hold on to your hat. I'm going to turn you upside down.
Now, the spacecraft at the present time is in a slow roll as part of the passive thermal control program to maintain temperatures.
You have to literally just pinch yourself and ask yourself the question silently, do you really know where you are at this point in time and space and in reality and in existence? When you look out the window and you're looking back at the most beautiful star in the heavens, the most beautiful because it's the one we understand and we know, it's we're home, it's humanity, it's people, family, love, life. And besides that, it is beautiful. You can see from pole to pole and across oceans and continents, and you can watch it turn and there's no strings holding it up. And it's moving in a blackness that is almost beyond conception.
Right, how's that tape recorder? Is the RPM up to nominal?
Yeah, it works pretty good here in 0G. It works better than it does down here on the ground. We're ready for the news now.
Okay, let's see. The Beatles have announced they will no longer perform as a group. The quartet is reported to have made in excess of $500 million during their short musical career. However, rumors that they will use this money to start their own space program are false.
That's about it for news. A recap of the top 10 teams did yesterday. Ohio State beat Purdue 42-14. Texas beat TCU 69-7. Tennessee lost to Mississippi. Final score on that one was 38-0. Notre Dame won over Georgia Tech last night 38-20. And of course, Purdue lost to Ohio State.
When the sunlight shines through the blackness of space, it's black. But I was in sunlight and I was able to look at this blackness. I mean, what are you looking at? Call it the universe, but it's the infinity of space and the infinity of time. I'm looking at something called space that had no end and at time that has no meaning. You can really focus on it because you've got this planet out there, this star called Earth, which itself is in its blackness, but it is lit up because the sunlight strikes on an object, strikes on something called Earth. And it's not a hostile blackness. Maybe it's not hostile because of the beauty of the Earth that sort of gives it life.
Throughout the flight, the times when one could sit back and really appreciate what an amazing adventure this was only during those little periods of time when you had a chance to stop and do the things which you weren't programmed to do. A lot of times, but when there was nothing else to do, or after everybody going to sleep, and I couldn't, I'd open up the window and look around. One thing every spacecraft ought to have is a huge window. Looking back at the Earth was a pastime that I never really got tired of.
Who have you got up now?
The other two guys are pretty sleepy. They sacked out again, so I'm closing the fort down for a while.
Biomedical data recently was monitored, and the CMP was soundly asleep while the commander was resting, but perhaps not soundly asleep.
You got the Black Watch watching you tonight.
You picked up the night shift, I see.
Yeah, it's turning out to be kind of quiet, too.
We like it that way.
When you're out there in this little command module, you see the risk you're taking because you realize that if the glass breaks or if the computers quit working or the electrical system quits working, you're not going to get back. And you have time to contemplate this. You have time to think about it, and you have time to run it through your mind a lot of different times.
How far away from Earth now, Jim, about?
It looks like you're approaching 150,000 miles. Frank, we had a little eggnog over at Charlie Duke's tonight. Val Anders dropped by. She's looking fine. Tell Bill she's doing real well.
Right. Thank you.
Everything that I know, my family and my possessions, my friends, my country, it's all down there on that little thing. And it's so insignificant in this great big vastness of space.
Here in Mission Control, the coffee cup has become an appliance second only to the headset in usefulness here.
Let's cycle through some of our consumables and other items this morning and tell you what we see. And all this looks quite normal.
Lights, camera, action.
We'll show you some of the type meals that we have on Earth. Matter of fact, on this flight, we've carried along pieces of bread. And along with the bread, we have a ham spread. And I'll show you, I hope, how easy it is to spread some ham. Environment of zero G.
Oxygen in the service module, which provides breathing oxygen for the crew. Apollo Houston, try SCE to auxiliary, over.
NCE to auxiliary.
SCE to auxiliary.
okay? Let's make sure that we don't do anything that's going to blow our CSM electrical power with the batteries or that will cause us to lose fuel cell number two.
On panel 276, under instrumentation power control. Open CB number 3 and number 4. Close the SN feed 1 and 2 circuit breakers. Cycle the Parker valve, and then open the SN feed circuit breakers on panel 11. Hey, it's off. It's off.
That sounds beautiful, troops. It's exactly what we wanted to see.
Early, my hat's off to the guys in the trench. I love them.
And by the way, welcome to the Moon's Fair. You're in the influence.
One of the things different about a lunar trip is you don't pass any place on the way. Going to the moon, you leave the launch pad, then you leave Earth orbit, and then a couple of days later, after passing nothing, all of a sudden you're at the moon. And that lack of waypoints, to me, had an effect of making it seem a little magical or mystical getting there.
This is really a rugged planet.
We're drawing closer to the moon with the Apollo spacecraft. Our LOS clock, loss of signal clock, continues to count down until that time that the spacecraft will pass out of communications range over the backside of the moon. On approach, the spacecraft sort of dives towards and behind the moon.
It was a totally different moon than any moon I had ever seen before. It was in this eerie shadow, no motion. Utterly silent. It sort of gave one a feeling of foreboding. It didn't seem like a very friendly or welcoming place.
Apollo, this is Houston. Your goal for LOI.
Go ahead, Houston.
Jim, you are go for the burn. Go for the burn.
Okay, Apollo 8 is go.
You're going too fast to orbit the moon. You're rocking on ready.
Hey, 2 minutes, babe. Give it a final trim. Burn time is 15 seconds, so it's going to go in a hurry.
You're in the burn position. You're ready to go.
Maybe let's make this one.
And then you look, and there it is.
35 seconds.
And it's 2001 type stuff. The old moon's just growing magnificently fast, and it's just filling up that hatch window, and you're drifting into the shadow.
Okay, baby. Hey. 7, 6, 5, 3, 2, 1, burn.
Burn.
Like I said,
we are burning.
Sooner to go. Okay. 78 to go. 50 to go. 20 to go. Stand by, Tom.
Shut down.
Oh, beautiful. Beautiful.
Charlie Houston, he got the burn off. We're in good shape.
Well, I tell you, we are down among them going backwards. You know that?
You've worked so long and so hard, and finally you're here. The burn has gone well. You know you're in lunar orbit. You know the orbit is good. You're right where you wanted to be. I mean, it just looked like you could reach out and touch it.
Apollo now traveling over the backside of the moon. The crew should be seeing the features, the rugged features, moving below them at a high rate of speed.
Oh, Charlie, we just saw Earth rise, and it's
got to
be magnificent.
Charlie, it might sound corny, but the view is really out of this world.
Okay, Davey, you ought to start getting your hatch closed.
Say again?
You better start getting your hatch closed if you're not already doing it.
I was disappointed. I wanted to go with them so bad I could taste it. As far as I was concerned, that was what it was all about. Not only going to the moon, but going down the surface and walking.
We're now less than 2 minutes away from the separation burn, which will be performed by the command module. When next we hear from them, the lunar module should be undocked from the command and service module.
You'll never know how big this thing gets when there ain't nobody in here but one guy.
John, don't get lonesome out there, John.
I wish I could go down there with him. You may not talk about it very much, but part of your training is coming back by yourself.
See you later.
Wish the damn thing could hold three people.
Grown quite quiet here in Mission Control. A few moments ago, Flight Director Gene Kranz requested that everyone sit down, get prepared for events that are coming, and he closed with good luck to all of you.
Get going. We is down among them, Charlie.
Roger, I hear you weaving your way up the freeway.
You're going right down US-1, Mike.
Right, copy. Looks great.
Okay, all flight controllers, gonna go for landing. Retro.
Go.
Econ.
Go.
Surgeon.
Go.
Fido.
Go.
Guidance.
Go.
Patrol.
Go.
Telcom.
Go.
GNC.
Go.
Capcom, we're go for landing.
Eagle, Houston, you're a go for landing. Over.
Okay, Houston, we'll give you a countdown. 4, 3, 2, 1, fire.
There it is.
Oh, baby.
See, it's sure coming down to that ground. Look at that rail. That's gotta be probably Diamondback right there.
When it pitches over and you get your first look, you know, there was nothing but 9 million craters after a terrible sinking feeling. Obviously didn't recognize a thing after studying all these photographs. Nothing looked right.
How you doing, Control?
We look good. You're fine.
Fudge, how about you, Telcom?
Go.
Guidance, you happy?
Go.
Fido.
Go.
Roger, you're a go. You're a go to continue power descent. You're a go to continue power descent.
Roger.
All during this power descent, I kept telling myself, Jim, this is not for real. You're back in the simulator. Just remember that.
Eagle, Houston, it's descent to fuel to monitor. Over. Eagle, Houston, everything's looking good here. Over.
Houston, I'm getting a little fluctuation in the AC, voltage now.
Roger. Stand by. Looking good to us. You're still looking good.
Houston, you're looking at our Delta H.
That's affirmative. Looking good to us. Over. Eagle, Houston, we'll monitor your Delta H.
Beautifully.
6+25, throttle down. 6+25, throttle down.
Roger, copy. 6+25. Let me try auto again now, see what happens.
We got data dropout. Roger, stand by.
We're going, that alarm?
If it doesn't reoccur, we'll be go.
We're going, that alarm.
Roger, understand. Go for landing.
Roger, we got good data.
Altitude, velocity, light.
Eagle, we got you now. It's looking good. Over.
4 forward, drifting to the right a little. Coming down to 23. 21 down, 33 degrees.
We're go, same type, we're go.
Picking up some dust.
And a couple of big boulders.
Coming right, got a good spot.
Not too bad. There comes a shadow.
Oh, are we coming in? Stand by for touchdown. Stand by.
Tranquility Base here. The Eagle has landed.
So there's a cheer in this room. What we're witnessing now is man's very first trip into space with a station stop along the route.
We got to stay, Houston.
T1. They came to a stop on the moon. There was kind of a letdown saying, you know, we're going to have to get it going fast again to get back home.
Neil, this is Houston. What's your status on hatch opening?
Okay, Houston, I'm on the porch.
Neil, this is Houston, loud and clear. Radio check and verify TV circuit breaker in.
Roger, TV circuit breaker's in.
Houston, roger, we copy and we're standing by for your TV.
I'm gonna pull it now. Houston, the Mesa came down, all right.
And we're getting a picture on the TV.
Got a good picture, huh?
Hey, Neil, we can see you coming down the ladder now.
The surface appears to be very, very fine-grained as you get close to it. I'm at the foot of the ladder. I'm going to step off the limb now. That's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
I had a bet with somebody who didn't really felt that Neil spent a great deal of time before he went figuring out his famous words, and they were not extemporaneous on the spot historical words. He actually felt that these words might have even been written for Neil by somebody else. And I said, well, I'll bet you $500 that when I get to the bottom of the ladder and nobody ever remembers what the second person to do something does anyhow, I'm going to say it may have been a small step for Neil, but it's a big step for a little fellow like me.
Ready for me to come out? Okay.
Now I want to back up and partially close that, making sure not to lock it on my way out.
So this person said, I don't know why you're going to do that. I'm going to tell you what to say. Okay, bet's a bet. So I bet this person $500. So when I got to the bottom of the ladder, I said,
man, that may have been a small one for Neil, but that's a long one for me.
12 Houston, we have you in blushing black and white.
What happened to the color?
Maybe the color wheel was hung up.
I can feel the wheels running because I can feel something in motion inside.
Why don't you go put your glove in front of the lens?
All right, we'll do.
That's coming in there now, Al.
Got the old camera running.
Okay, what change did you make?
I hit it on the top with my hammer. I figured we didn't have a thing to lose.
I can't believe it.
How about watch this?
I don't know if this will work or not, Charlie.
Well, in my left hand, I have a feather. In my right hand, a hammer. And I guess one of the reasons we got here today was because of a gentleman named Galileo a long time ago who made a rather significant discovery
about falling objects in gravity fields. And we thought that where would be a better place to confirm his findings than on the moon. And so we thought we'd try it here for you. The feather happens to be appropriately a falcon feather for our falcon. And I'll drop the two of them here, and hopefully they'll hit the ground at the same time. How about that? That proves that Mr. Galileo was correct in his findings.
We got a beautiful picture of you guys up down there.
Let me tell you, Bob, this flag is a beautiful picture.
Hey, John, this is perfect with the loop, you, and the old flag.
You really should set the flag up on a hill, Charlie, but there just ain't one.
I know, John. I'll put it right here. Big rock.
I was proud for our country more than I was proud for me. It was nothing that I did. I just happened to have gotten there at the right time. My background carried me through. But there were a lot of other qualified people that didn't go. Why my name came out, I don't know.
And we very proudly deploy it on the moon to stay for as long as it can, honor all those people who have worked so hard to put us here and to make the country and mankind something different than it was.
It was like sitting in the last row of the balcony, looking down for that play going on. While I was in the play, it was more like I was a spectator.
Tranquility, this is Houston. We'd like to say from all of us down here in Houston, and really from all of us in all the countries and in the entire world, we think that you've done a magnificent job up there today. Over.
Thank you very much. Have you had enough TV for today?
Yes, indeed. It's been a mighty fine presentation there.
Thank you. Couldn't enjoy it as much as we did.
Get some rest there and have at it tomorrow.
Okay, signing off. See you again tomorrow.
All systems on the lunar module are in good order. We have not heard from Tranquility Base since saying goodnight.
My mind's one that just goes constantly. So I took a sleeping pill. Slept like a baby. I had one dream that was very vivid. In my dream, we were driving a rover up to the north. And you didn't really feel like you were out there. It was untouched. The serenity of it had a pristine purity about it. We crossed a hill. I felt, gosh, I've been here before. And there was a set of tracks out in front of us. And so we asked Houston if we could follow the tracks. And they said yes. And we turned and followed the tracks. Within an hour or so, we found this vehicle. It looked just like the rover. Two people in it. They looked like me and John. Had been there for thousands of years. Not a nightmare type situation, nothing like that. Probably one of the most real experiences in my life. I'd have traded on a drop of a hat to go land on the moon. I'm one of these nuts. I like classical music. And I almost learned to like country and western. One of the things I took was Berlioz's Symphony Fantastique, which seemed like that was an appropriate thing to be taken to the moon. and I was floating along, just laying back and enjoying life. I just crossed the face of the moon, going towards the darkness. And here's this strange scene, this music, and it just seemed to put it all together in one moment that you could completely forget that this is a real situation.
This is Apollo Control Houston at 104 hours, 31 minutes now into this historic mission.
The lunar surface temperature in the sun should be around 135 degrees today. In the shade, the temperature would again be about minus 100 to minus 150 degrees Fahrenheit. That would be in the shadow of the lunar module.
Oh, look at that. It's a panoramic scene of beauty.
At the Earth out there, Houston, it looks like you're littler than a golf ball at arm's length now. Sure looks pretty, though. Really looks spectacular.
Seemed very unreal to me to be there, looking back at the Earth and thinking how far, far away it was. This is the moon, that is the Earth. I'm really here.
We're allowing about 5 minutes for the drive to station three.
Okay, safety belt front. And here we go.
How's it driving, John? Pretty easy?
Driving good.
And I'll tell you, Andy's never seen a driver like this. Barney Oldfield.
Charlie, what should we be heading for?
Those craters up there.
Don't tell me that.
Boy, this is so neat. You look like you hit it just about for our spot. See Survey Ridge down there?
Yeah.
This is gonna be spectacular. No, not through this crater. Yeah! Woo!
Let me see if you're nervous, Charlie.
Oh, Barney's really driving this beauty.
Only way to fly, Tony.
And boy, this is gonna be such a spectacular view, you can't believe it.
Well, that's good news.
We are here! You did it! Hey, that was a good stop. Those wheels just locked. Mark off.
Super. John, did you dust that TV lens?
Get some dirt in your eye, Houston.
Hey, that does a good job on the lens there.
You want us to go up and travel along that ridge?
Yeah, why don't you press on up there?
I think that the best place here for the ALSEP is to the LIM 11 o'clock position.
That sounds good, Charlie. And John, it's 266.
I felt very welcome there. You know, the moon's been waiting for us for thousands of years. Millions of years, maybe. Unless someone else has already been there before us at some time, that's possible. Although we didn't see any evidence of that. Felt like I was the only one there, but not an alien. Not an alien in terms of invading someone else's domain. I didn't find the moon hostile, or I found it very majestically beautiful. Bland in color, but majestically beautiful.
There's a look at that glass-covered one right there, John.
Pretty good size, isn't it?
Yeah. It looks like it's about 3 days old, so it must be on the order of 4 billion. Let's fill this one up, and then, rat. Bet you that looks like a comedy of errors on a tube. Yeah. Hold still. That is a crystalline rock, if I've ever seen a crystalline rock.
First one today.
Yeah. We gotta get over this ridge, John.
You wanna take off and go that way now?
Yeah. Hey, John, did you make those little footprints here around the sun?
Yeah, I guess I did.
Sure I did.
Ah, the old footprints on a crater rim. There's a good rock right there. Look at the size of that rock. I thought this thing was just right next door to us. Well, Tony, that's your house rock right there.
It's got black streaks coming out of it.
Man, this is tough going here. Hey, let me have a shovel.
Oh, I get it, man.
Just a minute.
Good deal, boy.
There you go.
I can't get going here.
Okay, and you've got about 10 minutes left before we'll have to leave.
Is that okay for you?
Yep, sure is.
338 is the soil sample. That is the best sample we got.
I know it.
I'll tell you.
You just had to steal time now, then. You just had to stop chipping at a rock and figure out that bringing back a little bit of some kind of thought and feeling was as important as bringing another chunk of rock back. And not being a machine, but being a human being, you have to stop and say, do you know where you are and what you're looking at? And try and take in those few moments of privacy you have, everything there is to take in that moment.
And you've got 5 minutes here.
And all of a sudden, you've got to get to work.
Here in the wonders of the unknown at Hadley, I realize there's a fundamental truth to our nature. Man must explore.
One of the things you got to stop and do, make sure, is to have fun, too. Because you're only probably going to come this way once.
I was strolling on the moon one day in a merry, merry month of December.
Now,
May. When, much to my surprise, a pair of bunny eyes.
Boy, is this a neat way to travel.
Isn't it great?
I like to skip along.
Not me, boy. Skip.
Or whatever you call it. I can't get my left leg in front of me.
It was almost dangerous. You lose sight of the fact that it's a vacuum out there, and if you spring a leak next to it, you're gonna be dead.
Uh-oh. I saw baby landing.
Yahoo! Boy, do I like to run up here.
I'm going out for the ballet when I get back. You learn another line of work up here.
Yeah, while you're bouncing around there, you might keep an eye out for a nearby crater.
All right.
I've been on my knees twice to get back.
John?
Yes, sir.
You are black from the knees down.
No way to avoid it. That's why I'm glad the pressure suit bends.
John, you are filthy.
I tell you, there's a bot called the Kel Blast. Hey, here's a rock I'd be glad to see in Houston.
Man, Tony, you don't know how much fun this has been.
We concur, John.
Having gotten away from the spacecraft, I was able to really realize what this place was like that we had landed in. I had tried to anticipate what it would be like for many years, but it was obvious that there was no way one could have anticipated what it would be like to stand in the valley of Taurus Littoral, a place deeper than the Grand Canyon and equally as spectacular, see this brilliantly illuminated landscape with a brighter sun than anyone had ever stood in before, with a blacker than black sky, And then to top the whole scene off in this blacker than black sky was a beautiful, brilliantly illuminated blue marble that we call the Earth. The path of evolution is now in space, as much as on Earth. Man has showed that as a species, mankind was willing to commit itself to living in environments that were completely different than those in which the species evolved. Put a shield of life around ourselves in order to protect the life within, but the willingness to go out there is there. We've shown that. The curve of human evolution has been bent.
Okay, then it's time to load up right now.
Okay, we're underway again, Tony.
Okay, we'd like you to drive gingerly up to the ALSEP area there.
Okay, we're going up.
We'll go right or left.
We want to head, just keep going west.
Oh, I'm sorry. Look to left. Gonna expect trouble from backseat drivers.
Okay, we copy that, huh?
Look at this baby. I'm really getting confidence in it now.
This back wheel's off the ground.
Charlie, whatever you do, don't hit that brake.
The Grand Prix driver's at it again.
This is about the neatest thing I ever saw.
It's back to the limb, right, Tony?
You bet your life. And you're well ahead on the timeline. You've been making good time.
He must have forgot something. Sure, I guess so.
Well, everything's running. We're just about to start up, slope here. Have we been climbing, John? Look at that pitch meter. Pegged out high.
Hey, we have been climbing.
Tony, we don't feel like we're climbing, but we've been climbing for quite a while here. And we're going up a steep, steep slope, John. I'll tell you.
Look at that, Charlie.
I don't see what.
Well, I'll be doggone.
Look at that!
Charlie, you said you were going to see some other tracks on the moon.
I knew it. Hey, we're going back down our tracks, Tony.
Okay, good show.
There she is, John.
Somebody up there likes us.
Don't run into our hole.
I felt like I was an alien as I traveled through space. But when I got on the moon, I didn't feel that at all. I felt at home there, even though the Earth was a long ways away. We could see it directly above, about the size of a marble, and realize that we're there, but by the grace of God. I felt like I was at the end of a thin cord that could be cut at any time. It was precarious, but yet I felt comfortable. I felt something other than just what we can visually sense. A spiritual presence was there. Perhaps it is because so many people on the Earth were focusing their attention. They were maybe sending signals to us somehow. I sensed, I guess in a way, much like maybe the first man on the Earth would have sensed, like Adam, or perhaps Eve, as they were standing on the Earth and they realized they were all alone. There was no one else on the Earth, but yet they had that special communication. And I guess it was similar to the feeling I had on the moon when I realized that Dave Scott and I were the only two on this vast planet, another world. We were the only two there. We felt an unseen love. We were not alone.
Hi, big guy.
Hi there, Charlie.
Our human completed its first exploration of the moon. May the spirit of peace in which we came be reflected in the lives of all mankind.
Some 7 minutes, 22 seconds away from ignition on the LIM ascent back into lunar orbit.
Capcom? Ecom. Surgeon. GNC.
Guidance, you happy?
Go.
Fido.
Go.
AFD. We don't have an AFD.
No.
FAO. Network. Recovery. Capcom, we're go for liftoff.
Tranquility Base, Houston, you're cleared for takeoff.
Roger, understand. We're number one on the runway.
The moon is different. It's become man's first outpost, our first footstep in space, where man was able to look back at the Earth and see the Earth and see himself in a different perspective.
6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, ignition.
As you leave, you're leaving this unbelievably beautiful, naked, charcoal ball out there in space. And you've been around the moon. You've been on it. You're seeing something that's familiar to you. That's home. That's where we live. There's where we left the lunar rover, and there's where we explored, and there's the mountains and the valleys. And it is, in a sense, has been a home, a life-sustaining home for you. And when you leave it and you see those things, you leave it with the same kind of feeling and awe that you left the Earth with several days earlier.
From rendezvous in the command module, Pete said to me, "You want to fly this thing?" And I said, "Well, yeah, I'd like to fly it." As I took the controls, I thought, "Well, wait a minute. The people on Earth in Mission Control aren't going to like this." And to show how he thinks about things, he said, "Don't worry about it. We're on the backside of the moon. They'll never know."
We say-
set sail on this new sea because there is new knowledge to be gained and new rights to be won, and they must be won and used for the progress of all mankind.
As time goes on, I truly do believe that you're able to pull out of the subconscious a great many things that you absorbed in those moments while you were there looking back at the earth. And I can almost transform my body, certainly my mind, through time and space instantaneously to that spot on the moon. I know where I am when I look at the moon. It's not just some abstract romantic idea. It's something very real to me. Stars are my home.